Let them praises give Jehovah. They were made at his command. Them forever he established. His decree shall ever stand. From the earth, oh, praise Jehovah. All ye floods, ye dragons all. Fire and hail and snow and vapor, stormy winds that hear him call.
Let them praises
give Jehovah, for his name alone is high.
And his glory is exalted.
Far above the earth and sky.
Well, let's continue on. We last week talked about the place of miracles in the epistles. We saw that there are some general references to miracles in the epistles, but there are no specific miracles listed in any of the epistles. The time of miracles is kind of drawing to a close. Apostles were able to do them and were doing them, and they laid their hands on people and were able to do them. And we'll see that as we talk about spiritual gifts, some people had the spiritual gift of healing. And other types of miracles were still taking place in that time, but we're not getting the specifics that we got back in the Gospels and even in Acts. I basically planned out and made my notes on these classes a few weeks ago, and I would take kind of the highlights of my notes and make a handout that I was giving you. Well, as I got busy trying to get in the swing of going back to work, basically I gave you my notes, and I did not always vet them as well as I should have. And so there are, last week and again this week, some of the scriptures that are listed, I think I misquoted them, and I didn't go back and fix those. But we may talk about some of those here in a little bit, some spelling mistakes and so forth. But I think the gist of it is what we want to do. This lesson, it kind of bothered me last night in that while I was thinking, I ended up waking up during the night and couldn't go back to sleep. And some of this stuff scares me a little bit. We're going to start talking as we go about false prophets. In fact, in the epistles, all the miracles that are mentioned, or most of them, are done by false prophets. They're not real miracles. And I get to thinking, well, I know that, you know, we know that if you are a teacher or something, you get put to a higher standard, and you have a higher bar to meet and so forth. Anyway, whatever it was, it got to my mind during the night last night. And number one, I think this is a serious subject. When we start talking about Scripture, it's serious. That being said, I also think what God wants us to know is not so difficult that we can't understand it. He made His plan simple enough that we can understand it. We can follow what He wants us to do. We don't have to know every detail that ever might be done. In fact, in my opinion, it seems like I've seen some good preachers in my day start going to grad school, and they decide that they need to determine something nobody else has ever determined before. And it has led to sometimes not good consequences, in my opinion. That being said, I don't think it's difficult what we need to know, but I think that it is important, and it kind of got to me. Anyway, let's continue with we talked about spiritual gifts, and I think we let's read two of these scriptures, Ephesians 4, 11 and 12, and Romans 12, 6 through 8, which talk about the purpose of miracles and spiritual gifts. And it makes it pretty clear what this purpose is when we get to there. So Ephesians 4, 11 and 12, Romans 12, 6 and 8, if somebody has those.
Now, these are the gifts Christ gave to the church. The apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and teachers. Their responsibility is to give God's people to do His work and build up the church, the body of Christ.
All right, that last sentence, to equip God's people and build up the church. That's why He gave those gifts. Romans 12, 6 to 8, if somebody has that.
Let him use it in proportion to his faith. It is serving, let him serve. If it is teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it is leadership, let him grow, govern diligently. If it is sowing mercy,
okay, and we'll talk about those that list again. But if we have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, each of us is to exercise them accordingly. And I was thinking that the words there was given for the common good, but maybe I was reading a different. If I have the wrong one written down again, or if that's a different version. Anyway, I mentioned, I think, last week that the word often used for spiritual gift is charisma, which literally means grace gift. In other words, we don't earn these gifts. These are what God has given to us as a gift. And there are various types, and then we just listed some of them. And I think the last thing we did last week was read 1 Corinthians 12, 8 through 10, and then verses 28 through 30, which is a couple of lists of spiritual gifts. And let's start with these, Romans or 1 Corinthians 12, 8 through 10. Okay, and down verses 28 to 30, he says, and God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, administrators, various kinds of tongues. All are not apostles, are they? All are not prophets, are they? All are not teachers, are they? All are not workers of miracles, are they? All do not have gifts of healings, do they? All do not speak with tongues, do they? All do not interpret, do they? And then finally it says, but earnestly desire the greater gifts, and I show you still a more excellent way. So we've got a list of 14 different gifts that Paul talks about in relationship to the Corinthians. Some of those may or may not be miraculous. Knowledge. A lot of people have knowledge that don't have miraculous powers. Some others, like the gift of healing, is in its own nature miraculous. And I've mentioned probably in this class, and certainly to many of y'all, I am not the type of person who ever has an original idea about anything ever. If I need an idea, somebody's got to give it to me.
Originality is forgetting where you got it.
Yeah, so all that I come up with here is some things I, in 66 years, have learned and a little bit of it sticks with me, and then when I'm developing a lesson, I go to a concordance and I start finding, well, where did I hear that? Where in the scripture is this, and so forth. And otherwise, I try to read people who I trust to some degree to know things and let them give me ideas. Then I'm passing them on to you. That being said, these are not necessarily my original thoughts that I came up with, but I would say that based on this 1 Corinthians 12, 13, 14, as we look at what Paul's talking about with these spiritual gifts, it seems to be that he is talking about those who have had hands laid on them and spiritual gifts given to them, probably in a miraculous sense. So even the knowledge, which people can study and come up with knowledge. But also, Paul could lay his hands on you, and you have knowledge that you didn't have before. That's miraculous. And I think this list that we just talked about are miraculous gifts, spiritual gifts. That, then, is opposed to what we see in Romans. And let's start off with Romans 1:11. What Paul says right here at the beginning of his in his letter to the Romans. So we have Romans 1:11, and then while we're reading that, somebody take a look at Romans 12:6-8.
1:11. I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gifts to make you strong.
Okay, I want to see you so I can impart, so I can give you spiritual gifts. And we just read that Romans 12:6-8. Just to refresh our minds, I'll read it again, but I can get to it. Since we have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, each of us has to exercise them accordingly. If prophecy, according to the proportion of his faith. If service, in his serving. He who teaches, in his teaching. He who exhorts, in his exhortations. He who gives with liberality. He who leads with diligence. He who shows mercy with cheerfulness. There's seven more spiritual gifts that he's talking about. None of those are necessarily miraculous. We can give because we are generous. We can teach because we have studied and are able to pass that on. We exhort because we are upbeat and we're able to make other people feel better about things. There are things that we develop through life that are spiritual gifts. Paul had not yet been to Rome to lay his hands on them to impart the miraculous spiritual gifts. Yes. Yes.
And I know Paul talked about doing everything in order in your worship service.
Yep.
And he says in that, if you don't have somebody that's able to interpret tongues, don't do it.
Yes.
Okay. And I think all of us are familiar with some of the religious groups of today that teach speaking in tongues. Another term is epilalia. But the fact is, they don't have anybody that interprets that. And so, it shouldn't be done. Yeah.
That is correct, and we'll talk about that a little bit more coming up. But that is one of the important things as far as today's miracles. Yeah.
Shroud of Turin has been verified to be 2,000 years old.
I did not. Is that the
the burial shroud?
Where that he was buried in? Which it may be.
Okay, it's an old piece of cloth.
Yeah,
but it's got a three-dimensional image that they can't figure out.
Only if you have a lot of imagination.
No, I don't mean that to increase what you're saying, but I think that it's easy to chase rabbit tracks, and this is a rabbit track. You know, the difference between the Reformation and the Restoration movements, okay? Reformation means you reform. So we were reforming the Catholic Church's beliefs. Restoration means going back to the initial source and belief being based on that. And we are restorationists. We are not reformationists.
Well, yeah, I'm not arguing the, you know, Catholics and their beliefs, but I'm talking about a specific object that...
Well, I'll tell you my short opinion on that. I got to go to Jerusalem and Nazareth for a little while and saw stuff, and they said, this is Mary's house, this is Joseph's house, this is, you know, all the things that they showed me that happened. And I thought, maybe it was, maybe it wasn't. It doesn't make a whole lot of difference. If it wasn't this, it was somewhere probably pretty close to here. And that's kind of what I think. Maybe that's the cloth. Maybe it's not. It doesn't really matter. But it's something similar to that. That's kind of the way I look at it. And
one of the things that happens, though, it's not just with the shroud. It's with a lot of different things.
There are those who believe in relics. But setting that aside, there's, and growing up in East Texas and being exposed to a lot of quote faith healers, unquote, all through the time I was growing up. There's a lot, some people that are always looking for something extra, something more than. And Paul wrote a lot about that. He wrote one whole epistle, Galatians and Colossians, to a large extent, about people who were being taught that they needed something more than just being a Christian. They needed something more than Christ. Well, okay, if we've got the shroud that Jesus was wrapped in, that's wonderful. It's a nice piece of history. But it doesn't tell me or doesn't do anything for my salvation. For that, I need Jesus Christ. And I find Him in Scripture. And if somebody can speak in tongues, well, and if it means something to them, so let it do. It doesn't do anything about my salvation. It doesn't bring me closer to God. It doesn't make me further away. It's just something extra. And according to the New Testament, I don't need anything extra. I just need Christ. And there were a lot of wonderful things that happened by Jesus and in the early church to get it up to the point, it could grow to the point that scriptures could start being circulated and people could be taught and know what Christ said and what the apostles said without having a miraculous revelation. And they had that. And they had it was delivered in such a way that it was guaranteed it was going to expire.
Well, for us, you know, we've all grown up in the church and, you know, we study the Bible all our lives and everything. But for the common lay people out there who just, you know, they toss to and fro by every whim and all this, that, and the other. But if they see, you know, this... the shroud and it puts a spark in their head that says, well, you know, maybe they're right. You know, maybe he was resurrected and
That would be a good thing, and for every time that we find something like that, which I think is a good thing, 10 people are going to be saying something, you know, that the Big Bang Theory or whatever it is. You know, there's always arguments. Anyway, I'm going to get back to this if I can. You have one more.
Religious relics is an interesting subject. Okay, we happen to have been in Cologne, Germany years ago, and in Cologne, the Cathedral of Cologne survived bombings during World War II. The spire goes up 400 feet, but anyhow, they have three coffins that are gold case encased. That are relics there. These were supposedly the bodies of the three wise men. And the reason why that they were believed to be the three wise men, that Constantine's mother said they were. Go figure. So, I mean, the basis of these things can just be off the wall.
All right. Let's get back onto this. All right. Well, a couple things I want to mention with this. Paul had not yet been to Rome. He wanted to come, and he wanted to impart spiritual gifts. They had some semblance of spiritual gifts. I think those were not miraculous spiritual gifts. By looking at the list of them, they were not necessarily miraculous. There are things that we can develop and so forth that God gives each of us gifts even to this day. On the other hand, the list that we have there of the 14 things in Corinthians, some are by their very nature miraculous. Healing is a miraculous power to have. Speaking in tongues, I think, is a miraculous something that God gives certain people that not everybody has, and you can't develop it necessarily. Some of them could be naturally gained and helped things. I think within this context, when you go back and look at what Paul talked about in chapter 11 with the Lord's Supper and how he talked to them about their abuse and misuse of those things, then we get into these spiritual gifts. Paul had spent a significant amount of time in Corinth, had plenty of time to lay his hands on whatever number of people he wanted to lay his hands on to impart miraculous spiritual gifts that these lists very possibly are all miraculous in what has happened, even the ones like knowledge that he says, I'm going to let you be filled with knowledge, and they have knowledge. As much as I am going to let you have the ability to heal, and you have the ability to heal. So then we get in, you know, chapter 12 ends, and there's a better way. And then he goes through chapter 13, which we're familiar with, that love chapter. And he talks about how important and so forth that love is. And then verses 8 through 10 says, and prophecy is going to be done away with, and all these other things, tongues will be done away with. Those things will be done away with that he's been talking about. Verse 10, but when the perfect comes, the partial will be done away. And so he's talking about the ending of those miraculous things that they were able to do in Corinth. Then he goes on in 14, the prophecy is a superior gift and so forth. And he continues in that context talking about miraculous spiritual gifts. I think that these lists in Corinthians are from the laying on of hands and a miraculous ability. The ones, the spiritual gifts in Romans were gifts that God gives each of us because he is gracious and gives us things that we don't deserve necessarily, but he gives us gifts. All of us have certain gifts that we're able to
enjoy, improve upon, and so forth. And any other comments with that in particular? The next thing I want to talk about is, moving down a little bit, it says, several New Testament passages warn of deceitful wonder workers and false signs. This is what got my attention as I was studying last night. When signs are mentioned in the epistles, they're referring to false signs from false prophets. Jesus warned all the way back in Matthew 24:24. And this is a somewhat of a difficult chapter in and of itself. But in 24:24 in Matthew, it says, "For false Christ and false prophets will arise and will show great signs and wonders so as to mislead, if possible, even the elect." That's kind of a big verse. This is saying a lot of stuff, as does a whole lot of that chapter, and I'm not going to get into the rest of that chapter, but I think that maybe has something to do with this. Somebody read 1 John 4:1. And this is another important thing when we start talking about false teachers. 1 John 4:1. All right, that's kind of a big verse. Test the spirits because they're not all from God. That's pretty important. So, it is a good thing to test the spirits. A lot of times, well, who are you to ask? Well, I'm doing it because God said to do it. I'm questioning whether or not you are a true prophet. I'm questioning whether or not what you're saying is what should be said. Then it talks about some of the things of characteristics of false prophets, disguise themselves as apostles of Christ. They preach another gospel. Galatians 1:6-8. We're pretty familiar with this verse when it's talking about preaching another gospel. What does that say? Galatians 1:6-8.
"I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you by the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let him be eternally condemned."
That says a lot. I mean, if we had an angel walk in and I was convinced he was an angel and he started telling me something, it'd be pretty hard to say, nope, that's not. And so when you trust, you know, you go to a church somewhere and you know that this preacher has studied and studied and studied and he knows a whole lot, he's forgotten more than I know. And he says something, it's really easy to believe him without testing it. And it is our responsibility to know this, to be able to test it. Because if it's not here, Paul is saying, it doesn't matter what is being said if it's different. And I remember talking to a guy who was a Mormon. And I said, well, it says very clearly, don't add or take away from. He says, it says that in Deuteronomy. He says, so do we need to quit at Deuteronomy or do we go on through Revelation? And if it's, you know, so what it says, when it says that in Revelation, don't add, he said, well, it's no different. The Book of Mormon is no different than the New Testament in that it is a more of the story. And I mean, my head's exploding. Think, how am I going to argue with that? So, knowing Scripture is important. We're not going to know all and everything about it, but it's important that we are able to come to some grasp with what this says, and this is, I believe, that this is from the beginning to the end of what we need to know. Moving on. They deceive for gain. This is kind of an important one. People want, and I think Titus 1:10, we may have this in our sermon this morning. I think that's about where we are in Titus. They do it for sordid gain, it says. People do it for money. You will notice in New Testament miracles, none of them were done for money, ever. Not one. They teach false doctrine. I think verse 11, that Titus 1, I have 10, I think verse 11 is where it talks about sordid gain. Teach false doctrine, 1 Timothy 4, 1 through 3. They claim to have visions, Colossians 2, 18 and 19. So these are some of the things that false doctrine or false teachers do that help us to understand that they're false teachers. Because it is very difficult to know everything about all of Scripture. But when these things start creeping in, that gives us a clue to at least look a little closer. So what happens to false teachers? And Revelation is a book of, what's the word? Not mythological. I just lost my word. Symbolic in many ways. However, Revelation 19, 19 and 20 has a sentence in there that there may be some symbology, but I'm kind of thinking this is kind of what it means. And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies assembled to make war against him who sat on the horse, against his army. And the beast was seized, and with him the false prophet who performed the signs in his presence, by which he deceived those who had received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image, those who were thrown alive into the lake of fire which burns with brimstone. That's what happens to the false prophets. And that, whether symbolic or not, it may not be a literal fire and brimstone, but it's a place that you don't want to be. I'm very confident of that. Jesus, even in Matthew, at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 7, 22 and 23, says, not everybody who says to me, Lord, Lord, is the ones following me. You know, he says, you can make it look good, and it's not good. And that makes it, that's what's bothering me. I'm thinking, man, I certainly don't know it all. How much have I said that was wrong? How many times have I led somebody to believe something that is not correct? And it started kind of weighing heavy on me. And it's important. Anyway, moving on from there. In the epistles, there were many times when miracles were appropriate and people could have used them. And we never have an account of them being used. For example, I've got several scriptures there, but 2 Timothy 4:20. Is one here. 2 Timothy 4:20 says, Erastus remained at Corinth, but Tromius, I left sick at Miletus. The guy's sick. Paul could have healed him. He said, I left him sick and left without him. Why would Paul not heal his buddy here? Because that was not the time nor place to do that. 1 Timothy 5:23, another one. No longer drink water exclusively, but use a little wine for the sake of your stomach and your frequent ailments. People have ailments. They're sick. And he says, take some medicine. Take some wine for your stomach. Instead of healing their ailments, he moved on and says, take care of yourself and left. And three or four more there. I won't read them all. But they could have been healed, but the time and place was not correct for miracles because miracles have certain reasons to be done. This was not the reason. I think maybe I've mentioned already, Mary, distraught as she watched Jesus on the cross, There could have been somebody to take care of her, but they let her be distraught. She sat there and watched her son die on a cross. Because that was not the time nor place for the miracle to happen. Yeah.
He did appoint John as chairman.
True. Then the question here is, why were they not healed? We're not told, but here's some suggestions that I got from somebody else. New Testament miracles were not selfish. After 40 days in the wilderness, Jesus could have turned the rocks to bread, but he didn't, because it wasn't about him. It was about defeating Satan and showing his power over Satan and so forth. He didn't help himself, but then when Peter cut Malchus's ear off, he put the ear back on. He helped. That was a time and place to show who he was and did that. Second, the purpose of these miracles was for confirmation. They were not just random acts of kindness. There were a lot of times that they had the opportunity to be kind to somebody and help somebody and do good things for somebody, but that is not the reason for a miracle. It's not so I can show off. It's not so I can, you know, you need something good. In fact, I was talking to Steve yesterday. He was talking about people who need things. A lot of people need a lot of things. That's not a reason for a miracle, necessarily. So,
we ask for things, one thing, but sometimes God says no.
And we wonder why, but yes.
And also, he didn't want to turn into like a traveling circus where, you know, the whole basis of everything in the New Testament boiled down to, you know, the miracles and whatnot instead of the message.
Right. And that's going to be this next lesson, the purpose of miracles. And finally, the third one that I have here is these are toward the end of this time. We just talked about in 1 Corinthians 13, which says, these things shall be done away when the time is right. And we're getting toward the time of being right. And these things are dwindling down farther and farther so that we don't have the purposes that we're getting ready to talk to for a miracle to need to be done. Sometimes when you think, now's the time for a miracle, well, apparently it wasn't because it didn't happen. Yes.
Sometimes the reason for the miracle was misinterpreted. When Christ fed the 5,000, they were going to make him king. And that distressed him. So he sent his apostles off beside himself, and then he joined them by walking on the water. They were misinterpreting the reason for that miracle.
Often that was done. Often that was done. And the last thing on this part of the lesson was there was one time in Matthew 7:15 through 18, somebody said, came to Jesus, says, heal my son. And he said, because your apostles were not able to do that. And Jesus healed him. And he turns to his apostles and says, you people don't have any faith. And I'm thinking those people had more faith than most of us ever dream about. But he said, if you had faith as a mustard seed, and that's where that deal comes, is because they were not able to heal this epileptic demoniac. Anyway, that is one of the few times that the apostles were not able, maybe the only time in Scripture that the apostles were not able to perform a miracle that apparently they tried to perform. And
only by prayer and fasting that this can be done, and I don't know for sure.
I don't remember if that's the same one or not. It could be. But anyway, that is what I got out of this is test the spirits because there's false teachers, false prophets, even still today. keep that next one, if you will, so I don't have to print those out. But we'll talk about the purposes of miracles, because when we start looking at people who claim to do miracles today, do their purposes match up with what biblical miracles were for? So, and we're out of time, so we'll start there next time. Thank you all for comments and for today.
Love, 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 love the gospel and our words of love. Love thy neighbor as thy brother. Love thy neighbor as thy brother. Peace, and
I still have joy after all the things we've been through. I still